Thank you. It is good to be back home. We've spent the last 2 weeks on our weekends up at Gladstone Camp Meeting presenting Follow the Star. And there was a lot of blessings that we got from that program. If you want to hear some of them, get a hold of Judy. She has all the stories. But I want to say good morning, Merry Christmas, and for my special friends, Feliz Navidad. Let's turn to song number 122, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. We will sing the first, second, and third verse, and can we stand, please? First. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, life and light to all he brings, risen with healing in his wounds. While he lives his glory by, born that man seated, please.
On behalf of Pastor Carey, it is my privilege and honor to welcome you to this beautiful Christmas program that we are going to witness to be part of today. We are so grateful for every one of you that is here today to honor the first advent of Jesus Christ. And we are grateful that we have the freedom to do just that in this beautiful sanctuary. I would like to ask you if you have a special prayer request that you like to be specially included in my prayer this morning. I'd like you to raise your hand. Please kneel for prayer. Heavenly Father, what a privilege it is to be in your sanctuary. We thank you for the freedom we enjoy, and we thank you for the cleanliness, for the beauty of this sanctuary. And our mind goes back 2,000 years ago when you came as a baby, there was no place for you except in a manger. So this morning we pray that the Spirit of God would be present here in this sanctuary, that would touch our hearts with your love as we contemplate, as we witness you as going from the manger, growing up, all the way to the cross. We are so grateful, Lord, that you have covered your divinity with humanity, that you may show us the way, that we may be with you eternally. And it is our desire to be with you. Heavenly Father, we have people that raise their hands for having special prayer requests this morning. I like to bring them to the throne of grace boldly and with respect, because you know their needs. I pray that you would minister to their needs. And for those people that are less fortunate in many places in this country and other parts of the world, I pray, Lord, that you would be with them. I know that there are people even in this church that are looking forward to freedom. Freedom from the oppression of the evil one. Freedom from the oppression of depression. Freedom from anything that oppress them. I pray that you would minister to their needs. To those people that are discouraged, in the valley of temptation, in the valley of sin, I pray that you would bring them out. You came to this world, according to the Bible, to give freedom to the oppressed. So I pray for freedom for those people that are looking forward to obtain victory over sin. I pray, Father, that you would remember the needs of our pastor, Pastor Carey. I pray that the Spirit of God would be with her, would touch her heart in a special way, would encourage her. I pray that you would heal her. Send a special angel to be near to her, even in these moments, Heavenly Father. And I also want to pray for this lady, Cheryl Young, for Kevin, for their daughters. I pray that you would minister to their needs. Kathleen Walter, and many others in our church that are experiencing difficulties. Heavenly Father, as we witness this beautiful program, I pray that the Spirit of God would be present here. May the Lord bless you and keep you as you listen to this beautiful program. May the face of the Lord shine upon you. May His countenance be upon you and give you peace. This is our prayer in your name. Amen.
Good morning. That's not my song.
Little children, we would dream of Christmas morn, of all the gifts and toys we knew we'd find, but we never realized a baby born one blessed night gave us the greatest gift of our lives. We were the reason that He gave His life. We were the reason that He suffered and died to a world that was lost. He gave all he could give to show us the reason to live. About gifts and the giving of ourselves and what that means. But on a dark and cloudy day, a man hung crying in the rain because of love, because of love. In all that I do, every word that I say, I'll be giving my all just for Him, for Him. And we are the reason that He gave His life. We are the reason that He suffered and died to a world that was lost. He gave all He could give to show.
Thank you very much.
Happy Sabbath, church family. Happy Sabbath. And a very Merry Christmas. One really short announcement. On a table out in front of the fellowship hall, there's food that was left on the table there, and that's free for the taking, so please help yourself and have whatever's out there. Christmas is an exciting time for children and adults alike, as we all, most all of us, participate in the tradition of sharing gifts with one another. It's a way for us to show our love for each other. Most people today trace the practice of giving gifts on Christmas Day back to the story of the three wise men who gave their gifts to the baby Jesus. As we know, these wise men had insight into who Jesus was, and their gifts were chosen with thought and with purpose. They gave him gold because they recognized it was a proper gift for a king. They gave him frankincense because that is what a high priest used when he went into the temple to represent the people before God. And they gave him myrrh because in ancient times it was used during the embalming process, and the wise men had recognized that this king would die for the world. But let's not forget that these were not the only gifts given at that time. There was a gift that was given to all mankind by God the Father, and that gift was his son Jesus. As we are told in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever should believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So Christmas is not about the gifts that we have under a tree in our homes that we will be given to others, for all those things will be gone one day. Even the gifts of the Magi are now long gone. No, Christmas is about what was given to us by our Heavenly Father. And that is a gift that will last forever. In like manner, should we not also look to give back to God an everlasting gift? In Mark chapter 12, verse 30, I think we find what our Lord wants. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. So, like the wise men today, let's give generously and thoughtfully of our material gifts through tithes and offerings, but let us also give to God our hearts, for this is the gift that our Heavenly Father desires to receive from all of us. The deacons will stand. Dear Father, thank you so much for the gift that you gave to us in your Son, Jesus. May we all appreciate that gift, and may we then in turn return our hearts back to you. And in his name we pray, amen.
beloved in Christ. Beloved in Christ, at this Christmastide, let us be our care and delight to hear again the message of the angels, and in heart and mind to go even unto Bethlehem and see the things which is come to pass, and the babe lying in a manger. Therefore, let us read and mark in Holy Scripture the story of the loving purpose of God, from the first days of our disobedience unto the glorious redemption brought us by this holy child.
Just a simple maiden with her hands stretched out to God, saying, Lord, thy will be done, I will abide. Just a simple stable. Looking back, it does seem odd that God himself would enter there inside. One wintry night, the starry universe went whirling upside down, and everything that was not the same. One wintry night, the supernatural birth left heaven and earth spellbound as the mysterious omniscient took a name. Darkness fled from the light. Let wrong was made right in just one wintry night. Just a simple carpenter who found himself in love with a girl bearing the child of the divine. Just a simple manger, yet somehow it was enough to accommodate the God of space and time. One wintry night, the starry universe went whirling upside down, and everything that was not the same. One wintry night, a supernatural birth left heaven and earth spellbound as the mysterious omniscient took a name. Darkness fled from the light. Wrong was made right in just one wintry night. Don't you know the angels were breathless as he stepped down off his throne into the cosmos his own hands had made? Don't you know that darkness protested as its reign was overthrown and victory was declared with love's display? One wintry night. One wintry night, the starry universe went whirling upside down, and everything that was not the same. One wintry night, a supernatural birth left heaven and earth spellbound as the mysterious omniscient took a name. Darkness fled from the light. Wrong was made right in just one wintry night.
And there were shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord.
Happy Christmas Sabbath. We'd like you to join us now in another hymn, It Came Upon the Midnight Clear, and we'd like you to stand, give you a chance to get up off your chairs for a minute. For joining us, please be seated.
And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And all went to be taxed, everyone, into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them at the inn.
Okay.
I've been asked to have you guys, if you can, scoot to the middle of the pews. I guess we have some people still coming in, and also those coming in, we still have some seats here in the chapel. Seat right up here in front row so you won't miss anything. But if you do see somebody, try to make some room for them to come in. At this time, I'd like to invite the kids to come forward for children's story. Now, as you come forward, I'd like you to collect the money that you see people having in all the aisles in the chapel. It's a little darker today, so you may have to watch and look really close to find the money. And to help them find it, well, you guys could wave it around to make sure it's more visible for them. And you can come up and put it up here in the church for Livingston Adventist Academy. I won't start the children's story until everybody's up here, so take your time. Let's also make sure we get the aisles in the chapel as well. You guys have been doing pretty good with the chapel. Chapel's taken care of. Let's make sure the aisles are taken care of too, because there are people still trying to get believe them. Thank you. You guys did a great job. Good morning, happy Sabbath. Boy, not one happy Sabbath from any of you. Happy Sabbath, guys. Let me ask you something. Are any of you excited? Why are you excited? Christmas is coming. Are you guys the only ones excited that Christmas is coming? Is anybody else here excited? Why is it like 10 days away? Are you sure? 4 days away. Today's the 21st, okay. 4 days away. So, I've talked to you about some Christmases I've had in the past. Remember how my parents were only children, so I don't have aunts, uncles, or cousins, but Christmases rocked. Well, I got some pictures of a couple Christmases I had. Now, they're gonna put them up here on the screen. Now, I want you to understand, these were taken with a little Instamatic slide projector my dad had, and I digitized it in the high-tech way of taking a picture of the slide. So it's perhaps not the greatest quality, but you get the idea. So I got this picture up here. That's not me. That's my that kid sporting the bowl cut's my brother. That's about 5 months after his God fried eggs on the sun to make it go down theory. What I took a picture of, I've included this, is that bike right there. I remember that Christmas big time because it came out and that was the first 10-speed bike in the neighborhood, probably the first one in the town, actually. They were kind of a new thing back then. And that was awesome. I also remember finding out later my dad got 15 minutes of sleep that morning. let's go to the next slide. Now, I have no idea what's got my undivided attention back there. But I want you to notice a couple things. One, it's hard to tell what decade this was taken in, but all the orange and brown is a pretty good clue. Okay. This is Christmas of 72. So I was a couple weeks away from turning 9. My brother's about a month away from turning 6. It just kind of worked out that way most years. The other thing I want you to look at is that tree, okay? You notice it's really shiny, okay? That was my tree growing up. It was amazing. That tree came in a package like this. Let's go to the next slide. It was packaged just like this in a box. Every one of those things had its own little tube it went into. We bought our trees in boxes, because we didn't know how to hunt and kill our own trees at that time. That was my tree growing up until I was probably 12 or so, but we ended up throwing it away, but we could buy it now. Let's go to the next slide. On eBay for a small price of $500. Yeah, there's a few other people I'm hearing that probably threw theirs away too, and wishing like, whoa. That's so bad they'll finance Christmas for you for $46 a month. Let's go to the next slide. This is my last slide. Now, this Christmas was a few years earlier. Okay, we were in a dorm room of a seminary. My dad was studying to become a pastor. And this is the Christmas of 69. Now, the person there on the right is my little brother. Now, I was about 2.5 years prior to his theory of God frying eggs on the sun. And you can tell just by looking at that photo, that boy ain't too bright, okay? Now, what I want you to really look at is the other part of that tree combination thing. Between my head and that can of Lincoln Logs, you'll see a color wheel, okay? Had four colors on it. had blue, red, green, and yellow. And I used to lay under that tree, because we didn't have presents under there until Christmas night. You know, they all got put under there in our family. I would lay under the tree and look up at it and watch it change colors, because that wheel would rotate around. There's a light bulb in behind it, and it would be blue. I would think about the Christmases, like maybe in the Arctic under a full moon. Then it would go around to red, and their bulbs were red, and the whole tree was red, and red's a good Christmas color. You know, it was just fun to look at that. Then green, and it'd be like the trees, maybe in the summertime, or if you lived here in the Northwest, you may be thinking Christmas in the Northwest. I didn't live in the Northwest. And then yellow came around. Why is there yellow? I mean, I can't think of a reason why there's yellow. I can only think of three reasons, maybe. One, an artist created it, and the other two primary colors are represented. So, hey, let's put the third one up so they don't feel, you know, misrepresented. Two, perhaps as a former school bus driver. Or three, it was a urologist. I don't know. Regardless, yellow is not a Christmas color. Okay? So the only thing you're doing, looking up, looking at yellow, is like, when does blue come back around? Then blue would make its way through. It was really amazing watching that. And guys, I want to let you in on a little something. As amazing as that was, it is absolutely nothing compared to the amazing thing that actually happened, the thing that we celebrate, the birth of Jesus Christ. We have the co-creator of the universe stepping down from his throne to come to earth. And he doesn't do this at this point on a cloud of glory, you know, trumpets blaring and everything else. He does it in the form of an infant. You guys were all infants at one time. Do you know that human beings are the only creatures that can't survive at all? They have nothing, that they will die. We will die. We don't have somebody there. It's not a position of power as an infant. You can't walk, you can't crawl, you can't talk, you can't do anything. And that's the way Jesus Christ came into the world, as an infant. And he did it for each one of us. That's the amazing thing that I want you guys to take some time to remember this Christmas. All right, now, before you go back to your seats, we would like to have the juniors, early teens, and primary stay up here. And if there's any of you out in the audience here that would like to come up and join for singing, anybody else can go ahead and have a seat. Thank you.
Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are coming to worship him." When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search for the young child. And when ye find him, bring me word that I may come and worship him also." When they heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they were come, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made. In him was life, and the life was the light of the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become sons and daughters of God, even to them that believe on his name. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
She'd pictured in the prophecies of old. It seemed almost impossible to think it could be true. But as she pondered in her heart, she knew this was heaven's child. This was heaven's child. In an earthen stable, wrapped in glory, meek and mild. Joseph felt with wonder as Mary sweetly smiled, because they knew this was heaven's child. Angels must have missed him as they sang him to sleep, but they marveled at the promises this baby came to keep. Joseph wept with wonder as he very sweetly smiled. As they wandered in their heart, they knew this was heaven's child. This was heaven's child. In an earthen stable, wrapped in glory, meek and mild. Joseph wept with wonder as Mary sweetly smiled, because they this was heaven's child. Mary's little baby boy was Joseph's pride and joy. Still they wished the world would see that he was so much more. He was heaven's child. He was heaven's child. In an earthen stable, wrapped in glory, meek and mild, Joseph wept with wonder as Mary sweetly smiled, because they knew this was heaven's child. Because they knew. This was heaven's child.
And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And when he was 12 years old, he and his parents went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast of Passover. And when they had fulfilled the days, as they returned, the child Jesus tarried, and Joseph and his mother knew it not. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. And after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. And all that heard were astonished at his understanding and his answers. And his mother said unto him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. And he said unto them, How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business? And they understood him not. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject unto them. But his mother kept all of these sayings in her heart.
Did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. The blind will see, the deaf you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nations? Did you child you're holding is the great I am?
this small child, this tiny, fragile life, carries with it the hope of all humanity. This small voice, now crying out in dark chambers, will one day still the raging sea, will call forth the dead to rise and live. This voice will declare it is finished and shatter the grip of sin. These small hands, now grasping for comfort, will one day restore sight to the blind, will break bread and feed the multitudes. These hands will feel the piercing cold of an iron spike and bring salvation through surrender. These small feet, now wrapped in cloth, will one day travel countless miles upon dusty roads, will stand firm upon rushing water. These feet will crush the snake's head and step forth from an empty tomb victorious. This small child, this wondrous, perfect gift, is Jesus, our Savior, the promise of eternity.
When we get to heaven, we'll probably be most likely one day be able to sing with such a beautiful voice that we just heard today. We'll be able to play the flute and the piano and the saxophone, the soprano saxophone, and we'll be able to accomplish things that we were not able to do this in this world. Looking forward to this promise of eternity. If Pastor Carrie would have been here with us, she would probably have related to you from her heart what I'm going to share with you today. There is no way I can do justice to Pastor Carrie. I cannot have her enthusiasm, her smiling, beautiful smiling face. I cannot have her tone of voice or the body language. But I'll do the best I can. I appreciate your prayers as we try to conclude these three serious sermons that Pastor Carrie presented here, the promise of eternity. The way had been prepared, and the child has been born. Born from a virgin, visited by unlikely shepherds, as well as wise men. Baby Jesus grew up to be a young man, a boy and then a young man, protected by his parents and by the angels of heaven until it was his time. His mission begins, his public mission begins. He builds up a team of unlikely disciples, and he called them to walk with him for a while. They would see him heal, calm, and restore. Then, as Jesus' mission draws to a close, he falls down to the ground and prays, "My Father, if it is possible, take this cup away from me, but not as I will, but as you will." Jesus knew what must be done to secure our salvation. Jesus then was betrayed by his own. He was arrested. He was deserted by everyone, denied, mocked, and beaten. Then the soldiers led him to the place of the skull to be crucified. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out to be executed with him at the same time, one on the left and one on the right. The baby born that came to this world to redeem the world, now a man nailed to the cross. The same hands that broke the bread and healed the eyes of the blind and resurrected the dead, the same man was nailed to the cross. With one criminal on one side and one criminal on the other, he looked down to the people from the cross and he said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." But one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults, "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and save us." But the other one said, "Look, we are here because we deserve for our deeds. But this man did nothing to deserve this. Lord Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said, "Truly, I say to you today, you will be with me in paradise." Even at that moment on the cross, Jesus proved that not works would save anyone, but believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Then Jesus looked down, and at the foot of the cross stood Mary and her sister and the disciples whom he loved. He said, "Dear woman, behold your son." And to the disciple that he loved, he said, "Behold your mother." To the woman who had seen him taking his first breath, first steps as you learn how to walk, the first time he performed the miracle, in his final breath, he asked his dear friend to take care of his mother. And as crimson blood flowed through from his face, Jesus cried out with his final breath, "It is finished." He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. It is the great act of love that redeems each one of us. Are we willing to accept Jesus as our personal Savior? Christ spread out his arms on the cross, and he felt the pain of every single nail that was nailed to that cross. He carried the weight of our sins, of your sins, of my sins. Are you willing to run to him, your protector, your redeemer, your promise of eternity? Are you willing to let him change us? Are we willing to do that? When we look at the manger and at the cross, we realize that it was because of you and me, Jesus did that. Jesus died. We are the reason that Jesus came to this world. But someone may say, "Look, you don't know me. I am not good enough." And you are right. No one is good enough to be saved. No one can claim the right to be with Jesus eternally. It is only by the blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that the blood gives life. As we come before the cross of Jesus Christ and nail at the cross, I saw this wonderful wise man came and knelt before Jesus the cross, with their gifts, is there anything that we can bring to Jesus to be worthwhile for us, to recommend us before God? Is there anything? The answer is no. But there is something that we can do. We can open our hearts. You see, Jesus could have been born in Herod's palace or any other palace or beautiful place, but he chose to be born in a manger. And today, he's looking for men and women, children and young people to become part of their lives, to be born in their hearts. Would you be willing to open your heart to Jesus and accept him as his personal, as your personal Savior? Would you be willing to do that? So God help you. Jesus is able and willing to guide you and to give you victory over anything that you are concerned about. He's able to provide for you. He's able to give you the sense of security in him that only through him you can be saved and you can have the assurance of eternal life. Only the Spirit of God can bring the presence of Jesus in our hearts. Is this your desire, to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, to bring the promise of eternity, Jesus Christ, in your heart? Is this your desire? So God help you.
So we might live. precious light in Bethlehem shines for you and for me. Darkness can no more condemn. His love is all I see. His love is all I see. And from his love so glorious, we receive the gift, God's only Son, who came for us to die so we might live. Peace on earth in Bethlehem, forever he will be.
Please join me in singing the last hymn, hymn number 132, O Come All You Faithful. Please stand.
Adore him, Christ.
Amen. You may be seated.
Was that powerful or what? If you would like to thank the participants today, would you please join me in just a round of applause to say thank you? There have been few times and I've been as moved as that. As you exit today, we are going to have some deacons waiting at the exits for you. We invite you to give a gift to help with the causes of those who are experiencing hardships. 100% of it goes straight to the need as identified by our leaders. At the end of this prayer, I'm going to invite you, the congregation, to say amen. If you feel so moved, please do so heartily. I want to, in this prayer, I came across something that I want to remind us of. It's based on Matthew 6:6. And it's found in Steps to Christ, page 93, two sentences. Prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. Prayer does not bring God down to us, but brings us up to Him. Thank you, Father. I came to this church 20 years ago. I didn't know a soul. And you took me in. You're my family. Listening to the program today, I was struck that God feels the same way about us. That is so powerful. In this, I have discovered that all we have to do is willing to be willing. I invite you to bow your heads with me for prayer. Father, we want to say thank you. Our service today has been to you, for you, about you. But in that process, you also reach out to us. You see us, you made us, we are specifically designed by you. We're your children. We are your family. And you desire to connect with us through your Spirit. You see all of our needs. You know the things that Satan does to us. I ask for something very specific today, Father, that no one would leave here without knowing that you desire to be connected as family, that your power is freely available, that your presence restores, renews, and changes us, and that we are strengthened by you in us. May we go forward with a new sense of your presence, Father. As we celebrate your birth, let us also know that the equally strong and even more powerful result of your birth is that you desire us. I ask for safety for all of our family, for our loved ones. You know our needs already. We come to you with that in order that we might experience you more fully, to know that you have us firmly in your hands, Father. We thank you for being our dad. And the congregation said,
amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. worked out. I'm just waiting for you to go Jerry Lee Lewis on the piano. Yeah, I enjoyed doing the hits.